Thank you. I think I hear methodology and tools for education quite strongly, and I hear action, so that is a very good start. So we had groups 3 and 5. Can I invite group number 1?
Our expectations are to have an overview about the Islamophobia in each country and also to share our best practices. We would like also to see the gender challenges in Islamophobia, because we know that we have cross-discrimination and most of victims are women. Then how we can tackle this way of Islamophobia. And we would like also to see how we can mapping Islamophobia. This is important to have an overview about the Islamophobia world, to know, for example, which are the roots, the categories of victims, of fields where the Islamophobia happened, and such typology. And we would like, our last concern is to have such international online challenges network, to see how we can, in this no hate speech movement, work together to have a relevant action in our country, but we act local and we think global. It's very important. Maybe the concern, so it's not time. We have 3 concerns. The first one is not to be able to put into practice what we learn inside this seminar. The second one is to have a superficial level of analysis, and we know that we don't have all the same knowledge about Islamophobia, and it's important to grow up together, but we don't like to stay in a superficial level. This is important. And the third one, and I think it's very important concerns, is not to reach the target groups, the groups which promote or develop Islamophobia, because I think we are convinced here that Islamophobia is an important challenge, but the people who need to receive our message, I think they are not here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think there are more shared concerns here. I wanted to concentrate in this bit now on expectations, and I promise we come back to concerns and contributions after lunch. I think it's also a question of time management that we need to address with this. We had all the, what are these, odd or even numbers? Okay, yes, 2 and 4 are left. So maybe we start with 4 to hear the expectations.
So a lot of our points are already mentioned, but I'll mention them again just because they're important. We talked a lot about the importance of finding good approaches, educational approaches to talking about and teaching about Islamophobia, and to kind of find innovative solutions and innovative ways of doing it. We also talked about exchange of experiences and of good practices. I mean, there's no need to reinvent the wheel. If there is, you know, organizations who already have found a good way of talking about it and of handling the problem, it would be good to learn about. We also talked about the importance of better understanding kind of the multiple factors that lead to Islamophobia, and also to get knowledge of, and if there are surveys or any other research done on the area, to kind of have that so that when you go into meetings or you go into a school, that you have something to show why this is important and the extent of the problem. I think that's very important because, like Mr. Gomez said earlier, I mean, for a lot of people, they don't see this as a problem at all. Islamophobia doesn't exist. We don't even want to talk about that, the term Islamophobia. I think that was basically it. If any of you remember something that I forgot, please do. yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And then it's down to group number 2. Okay, yes, then group 5, if you haven't spoken yet, yes, all right.
Okay. Most of it echoes what's already been said, but we expect to hopefully not only find sources of cooperation, but also partnerships, very genuine partnerships that we would like to build and maybe work together in the future. One of our expectations, we've kept it very broad, and we kept it broad to say just to learn, and we broke that down into saying that we would like to know about the current very general situations of Muslims and Islamophobia in terms of the legal, social, and cultural aspects across all the different countries in the room at the very least. And we'd really like to hear about models of best practice from other countries, but also what not only what has worked, but maybe approaches that haven't work so well so that we can maybe avoid them. And perhaps search for some opportunities within the room for some of the youth that we do work with, some genuine opportunities for them to get involved in specific bits of work that people might be doing in the room. Group people, if there's anything I've forgotten, shout. No?
Thank you. Is there any group that has not went and I missed? No? Good. I think we will address a lot of your expectations. I do hope we meet the objectives of the seminar, but this is also a mutual commitment to the objectives of the seminar that we need to share. And I think when it comes to educational tools, we will spend quite a lot of time tomorrow on that. And when it comes to the movement, we will already start working on this tonight to also get you on board in the campaign and to start contributing to the 21st of September action. And I think this is a very important point to keep in mind and to stress and create the necessary time in the program. I heard a lot that you would like to have an overview of what's the latest in terms of Islamophobia, in terms of the research, what are the global trends. And we foreseen that would be an expectation in such a seminar. And we've invited Jasmine Zain for this. Jasmine is a professor at the Wilfrid Laurier University in Canada, and she has researched quite extensively on the topic. And she's going to give us a presentation, an input to particularly address this need to see the main forms and features that Islamophobia takes today, the discrimination against intolerance against Muslims. You know, how does it manifest? Jasmine, I pass the floor to you.
Thank you very much, Roxandra, and welcome to everyone. I'd also like to just begin by thanking the Council of Europe for inviting me to be part of this seminar, and to the OSCE as well for the collaborative work that I've been doing with them over the last few years as well. So it's my great pleasure to be here and to share with you in this seminar some information, reflections, research that I've been doing on Islamophobia for quite some time. As Roxandra mentioned, I come from Canada, from Ontario, and I'm a sociologist and an ethnographer and work in the field of race and Muslim studies. And so a lot of my own research has actually been on Muslim youth for over a decade now. And so it's actually very inspiring for me to come here and to be part of such a transnational collaboration and dialogue. I think I have a lot to learn from everyone at this table. And hopefully through this presentation, I'll invite you to also ask questions, make comments where you feel relevant, so that this can be a little more interactive than just myself talking, because as was pointed out, there's a lot of expertise at this table, and I'd love to draw on that for this presentation. How well can everyone see the PowerPoint? Is it clear, or should we close blinds or turn off lights? Is it okay? Okay. A bit darker? Okay, so I'll just keep talking while they while they do that. So I've been asked to examine or bring to light some of the manifestations, challenges, and responses to Islamophobia. I've got a lot of images up here because images are very prevalent in the representation of Muslims, and they resonate in very particular ways through various things like political cartoons and so on. And so these are just some images that I drew from various sources that represent the way Muslims are often perceived. And I think the one in the middle is very, very significant, particularly around the kind of work I've been doing with Muslim youth, because my study has been looking at Muslim youth in what I call the 9/11 generation of Muslim youth in Canada, and how the war on terror and the politics of empire have actually affected their sense of identity, citizenship, and belonging within the nation. And when you see this image of a young Muslim male with all of these labels attached, you know, it's to his body, about terrorist, you know, Saddam, Al-Qaeda, fanatic, radical, and so on. These markers are very much the way Muslim bodies have been coded in predominantly the post 9/11 context, although Islamophobia didn't begin on September 12th. It has a longer history, and I'll talk about that. But the way in which these negative meanings get mapped on to particular bodies, in this case Muslim bodies, has a lot to do with how Muslim youth see themselves and see their choices, and in fact doesn't affect their choices in the world. And we'll talk more about, you know, the impact of that kind of stereotype and labeling. But I thought it's a very powerful image to show. I guess the starting point is to talk about what do we mean by Islamophobia. I'm actually very happy that this term is being used, because 4 years ago when Tangkut invited me to be a partner on developing the guidelines, there was a lot of debate about that language even being part of the document, part of the guidelines. And so I'm happy to see that, you know, that within those 4 years that there is a commitment to actually using language that names oppression. And so my colleague was talking a bit earlier, Rhee, about the definition of Islamophobia. Mine sort of echoes that, but takes it a little bit further. So Islamophobia can be defined as a fear and hatred of Islam and Muslims. And it's often left there. It's often left, the definition, at this kind of fear and hatred, this sense of irrational kind of hatred. And yet, I would argue that, as in most forms of oppression, there is a logic behind it. It's irrational, but there are dominant logics that support it, and that's why those forms of oppression continue to be reproduced. So, and they also have manifestations. So I've extended the definition to include that a fear and hatred of Islam and Muslims that translates into individual, ideological, and systemic forms of oppression that support the logic and rationale of specific power relations. So we need to talk about power relations when we talk about racism, Islamophobia, or any form of oppression, because they shore up relations of power. And in order to really combat these manifestations of oppression, we need to look at them in these broader dynamics. When we talk about fear, and we talk about irrationality, and we talk about intolerance, we're talking about what happens among individuals, right? And intolerance is a term, we were discussing this in my group earlier, that many of us sort of, you know, bristle over, because it seems to be, first of all, when we tolerate people, it's the lowest common denominator, right? We're not talking about acceptance, we're not talking about equity or inclusion. And I would say that institutions like that language, governments like that language. Why? Because it puts the responsibility in the domain of individuals, and it creates a space of innocence for institutions and governments where they don't have to look at complicity, because intolerance is about individuals. But the problems that we're facing with Islamophobia are much bigger than that, and they do include organizations, institutions, and governments, and policies. So I think it's important to reference that in the language that we use, in the way that we break down and understand the terms in terms of power. So, as I said, Islamophobia did not begin on September 12th. It was not just the aftermath of the tragedy of 9/11 that led to Islamophobia. In fact, my research on Muslim youth was happening in the late 90s, and a lot of what we hear and see today was echoed at that time as well. So while it's important to look at September 11th as a sort of contemporary manifestation of Islamophobia, or rather look at September 12th, where that began, and we see the impact quite quickly. It's important to sort of look back and say and realize that this isn't something that just developed at that time. And so I've just done a bit of a history, very briefly, of Islamophobia that has a genealogy that takes us back to the first Muslim community that in the 7th century Arabia that was vilified for their beliefs and who were persecuted and exiled. And then sort of fast-forwarding, we can look at the Crusades, the expulsion of the Moors in Spain in 6th century, European colonization of the Muslim world as other historical events that created negative discourses about Muslims that served particular political agendas at the time and could be seen, although weren't named at that time, but as we look and reflect back, we could see those as instances and campaigns of Islamophobia. And so what that tells us is that Islamophobia has been constructed as an ideological tool in many different historical moments and contexts to legitimate campaigns of political, social, economic, and military domination. And I think it still exists in that form today, but with different, you know, contexts that we're looking at. So just too important to remember that there is a genealogy and a history. So other related terms, and there's often a lot of debate among scholars and, you know, activists and people who are working in work that deals with oppression, deals with Muslims, is, you know, do we talk about Islamophobia or do we talk about anti-Muslim racism, and are these the same things? How are they different? And so when we talk about anti-Muslim racism, it places the issue of discrimination against Muslims within a broader framework of racism, which is important, and implies the racialization of a religious category. And so it's connected to Islamophobia, but I wouldn't say it's exactly the same, although both terms can be relevant when used in context. So when we talk about the racialization of religion and we want to inscribe an understanding of race within the context of how religious community has been vilified, anti-Muslim racism is a term that can be used to signify that particular aspect of the dynamic. Islamophobia is a broader term that encompasses more than just the anti-Muslim racism, but anti-Muslim racism is significant as well. Every form of racism has its own history, its own trajectory, and as we go around the table and, you know, we have people from all parts of Europe and internationally, how Islamophobia resonates within your context will depend on the history of your nation and the Muslim presence within that nation and the history of your country's relationship with the so-called Muslim world. I come from a white settler country, and so it's a very different context than what we might see in Europe in terms of how it manifests. So those historical trajectories and circumstances are very, very important. But both talking about Islamophobia and anti-Muslim racism are important terms to remember, but try to sort of understand the distinctions and ways in which they can be operationalized. So there's also a lot of talk about, well, is Islamophobia the new anti-Semitism? And these forms of discrimination also have different histories, right? Particularly in Europe here. And the manifestations are similar, and so we shouldn't equate them. I think it's not about creating competing oppressions, right? That doesn't get us anywhere. But it is important to maybe look at the ways that these forms of oppression use similar strategies to sustain themselves. And so, for example, the manifestations are similar in terms of the vilification on the grounds of race and religion, how it's affected these groups as matters of xenophobic state policies, negative stereotypes, everyday racism, and acts of hate and violence. So they've manifested through the everyday to the level of policy in similar ways, but of course have different histories and different implications. So they're not the same thing and shouldn't be necessarily understood to be the same, but it's important for those of us who are working in the field of combating these kinds of discrimination to understand the distinctions and the similarities. I think one thing that's significantly different in this era versus the sort of early anti-Semitism in Europe is the proliferation of the internet and social media and the ability for those negative stereotypes to circulate in very unprecedented ways. And I think that is one thing that is very powerful, and that's why I'm very glad to be part of a forum which is actually looking at manifestations of hate through the internet, social media, online forums, because it takes it to a whole other level. It takes it to reaching corners of the world where it may never have gotten to prior to that advent of this technology. So it's a very important project. So just to break down a little bit more, when I said the definition of Islamophobia, the hate against and fear against Muslims and Islam translates into individual, ideological, and systemic forms. I want to just break that down a little bit and talk about that. And please feel free to add in if you know, anything resonates for you or you want to share from your own experience in the grassroots of your work. So if we think of oppression as a kind of iceberg, what we see at the tip of the iceberg in terms of manifestations are often individual actions. So what we see happen in the everyday, people's everyday lives, that's what's visible in terms of when we talk about racism or Islamophobia manifesting as an everyday action. What we don't often see are the ideas behind those actions and the systems that sustain them. And so it's important to look, you know, not just at the tip of the iceberg, but what's underneath the surface. So let's do that a little bit. So if we look at the dimensions of Islamophobia, breaking down that chart, if we look at individual actions, these could be things like name-calling, vandalism, hate crimes, exclusion. And there's others that we could probably talk about. Does anyone have anything to add to that list of sort of individual actions that you may have experienced or heard of with the constituencies you work with? How it manifests in the context you're working in on an everyday kind of level? So we're going from, for example, name-calling in schools to people being victimized. There's instances. I used to wear hijab myself, actually, so I was much more visibly Muslim during the time where Islamophobia became quite rampant in North America. So I actually had someone rip my hijab off at the time. And so I don't know if that's, has anyone else experienced that or heard about things? I see people nodding. So these are things that are happening, you know, 10 years later. So that's an act of individual action, right? I'll give some more examples later, but if you think of some, just jump in. So those individual actions don't come out of space or just out of thin air. There are ideologies and ideas that lead to those kinds of actions being justified. So, for example, some of the ideas, and you can add to this list, things like immigrants are taking our jobs. So, whether it's Muslims now, it was other groups in the past, you know, Canada has its own history. Everyone likes to think Canada is this bastion of multiculturalism and we have no discrimination. A cab driver in the U.S. told me that one day. Oh, you're talking about racism? How is there racism in Canada? It's like, okay, ask the Aboriginal people about that and we can have some conversations. But, you know, so when you talk about immigrants taking our jobs, there's always been some group that's vilified for coming in and taking over. That can galvanize a lot of the hatred, and those individual acts somehow seem justified then. Or, of course, Muslims are terrorists. So those kinds of ideologies that circulate shore up particular kinds of actions, or justify and legitimate particular kinds of actions. Does anyone have any other kinds of ideas that you think are under the surface that are there to shore up or legitimate particular kinds of individual actions of Islamophobia that you've heard of, experienced? Yes, go ahead.
If you use your mic, but...
I was just saying jokes.
Absolutely.
So there's always an undertone. For example, in the UK, for me, calling someone a paki, I think that's very derogatory. But often happens as a joke, but I think there's always something underlying that.
Yeah. Very good point. You know, the way those remarks aren't often, you know, in the days now of contemporary racism, it isn't always just in your face in the same way. It's often subtle through jokes that are told, or it's often through name-calling like Paki, which I grew up with as well. So it took me many years before I could even say the word myself, because these words inscribe real trauma. You know, like racism, Islamophobia are forms of trauma. So we're talking about very, very deep forms of spirit injury that happen to people when you are growing up, particularly for youth, in a context where this is part of your day-to-day
existence. So name calling, but racial jokes, you know. And I'm going to talk about humor a little bit later and comedy as a form of resistance. But it's so important to talk about how those jokes can just seem so offhand and are used in ways that when people hear them, if you don't laugh, it's just like, oh, can't you take a joke kind of thing. So yeah, in the everyday it's inscribed, right, in the very banal interactions that we have and that are taken for granted. So yeah, that's another individual kind of manifestation. Any other examples or of ideas? Yes.
I think the religion, the issue of religion itself is a great matter. That they don't believe in our God, they are faithless.
Yes. Yeah, very true. And you know, we were talking earlier about, I think Farah mentioned, about conversations in a table like this where people are coming from post-communist states and how just the topic of religion resonates so differently when you're having those conversations there, where it's about religiosity is coded, particularly Islam, as such a matter of fear and a matter of, you know, perceived threat to national security, that there's a tendency to say, well, don't emphasize your religiosity, you know. And on the other hand, as you're pointing out, there's that pushback where, you know, these are our values, religion is part of our society, these people are coming in, and why do we have to accommodate their religious, practices, for example. And I know that's been an issue here in Europe with things like minarets in Switzerland, or, talking about prayer in schools and other kinds of discussions like that. So yes, the religion itself is a very big issue. Thank you. Yes.
Well, some other manifestations can be found in the language, because that's like in Proverbs. Some Proverbs show the stereotypes or some set expressions and sayings that are used in certain cultures. They show the fear and they show Islamophobia at times.
That's very interesting. So even Proverbs, can you give us an example by any chance that would translate well?
Well, I have some examples in Russian, but...
Were they translatable or are they too...
They are culture specific, but like we have the Tatar nationality.
Yes.
Or ethnicity, and as a Tatar, in Russian means like being destructive. So just one of the examples.
Yes. Thank you for sharing. Yeah, and that's another point, right? That becomes very common everyday way of referring to people. So you're constructing them as an abject, you know, category.
Like language helps us to construct reality, and if people use this in everyday life, they show the certain ideas that are deep.
Very good. So not only does it shore up particular kinds of ideologies, but it distracts us from others. So very important point. Thank you. Anyone else want to add in here? Okay, I was just going to go around the table. Yeah, Farah.
Actually, just going back to what you were talking about, jokes, I would take that even, extend that out further and say, actually, there's a cultural dimension to Islamophobia, certainly where we live, because Muslims are associated with a coloured culture, whatever that culture is.
Right.
And it becomes very frustrating when people are almost internalising Islamophobic ideas and statements, and it becomes normal to be able to say whatever you like. I think there was an idea of how Islamophobia has become okay as dinner table conversation.
Right.
And when you're internalizing things at that level, how do you challenge that? It's quite difficult.
Yeah, absolutely. And the way things get taken up, normalized as very common sense notions, so they're very difficult to dislodge. Yeah, thank you. And we're going to talk a bit more about media as we go along. Sorry, I don't know who else was next here. Yes, please.
In Belgium, we have some examples about mosques were attacked, and for example, the flesh of pork in front of the mosque. And this is symbolic attack, but with the blood, it's very hard. And we have also a certain vision of secularism.
Yes.
They imposed that for school or some jobs, they banned the hijab.
Yes.
And then it's very difficult for the women. Mm-hmm. And they want, in one hand, to promote emancipation, integration, but on the other hand, they make several obstacles for people in school and jobs. And we know that for emancipation, there are two very important challenges.
Yes, very good. So again, I'm going to actually just take that, come back to your point as well, because it will also relate to systems. But yeah, the issue of how, Muslim women's dress or halal food, you know, the use of pork, all of these things, again, become signifiers in this field. right, and become bases of exclusion and marginalization. Thank you. Did you have your hand up? No, sorry. Yes.
I don't know if it fits here, but just when we were talking about ideas, it kind of triggered something in me and to think about how, as human rights activists and campaigners, we're starting to see our own language used back against us. Mm. So we're hearing about, like, you'll hear racist ideologies talking about, white genocide and all of this idea of, you know, we're being, Europeans are being ethnically cleansed. So I think it's very interesting to see those ideas being subverted and thrown back at us. Now, I think they're easy to challenge, but it is interesting to hear our own language coming back at us, being twisted. So.
Right, and you're speaking to also the sort of resurgence and a very kind of virulent resurgence of right-wing nationalism and white supremacy that has taken shape not only in Europe but in North America as well, where you get that kind of language and that kind of association again about the xenophobia, about the dominant culture being eroded by strange foreigners coming to the shores and taking over. And that, of course, is a way to kind of undermine a lot of social policy that is about creating equity and accommodation for pluralism. So, yeah, thank you. Anyone else like to go? Yes.
I don't think it's necessarily meant in a bad way, but all the questions, I mean, I get personal questions in a culture that's not known for being very personal all the time, just because people hear so much about Muslims. So I can go into a meeting and in the lunch I will get all sorts of very personal questions about my life and my beliefs and, you know, what I'm allowed to do. And I find that very strange. And, you know, we become this, and especially as a visible Muslim and as a woman as well, we become this very, you know, interesting little thing that everybody wants to study.
Exotic and fascinating. Yeah. And and of course, the representative for 1.5 billion people around the world. Yes, so that's you. You're the one representative. Yes. Yeah, and that's a very common phenomenon, right, where a lot of Muslims are put on the spot and asked to represent, you know, or account for. Well, this is going on in the world, you know. What are you saying? Well, how do I, you know, answer to that? Like, I'm not responsible for what's happening somewhere else in the world. And but this sort of burden of representation, right, that a lot of particularly visible Muslim women often feel, because they're the most usually easily targeted and identified as Muslim, have to deal with on a day-to-day basis. Those kinds of questions that turn into interrogations and so that takes its toll. That definitely takes its toll. Thank you. Okay, we have three in a row here, so let's start here.
In terms of ideas, dominant ideas, I was thinking about the idea that Islam is in opposition to the West. So there's a big grand conflict going on, and you can't be both European and Muslim.
Right.
You have to have some kind of secret agenda where you're against many of the ideas. And also, in terms of religion, I thought, I think it's a wider phenomenon in terms of secularization or the decline of religion, that maybe Islamophobia is seen as less of a problem because it's a religious thing and people don't have so much respect for religion in many dominant sections in the government, because it's seen as, you know, an old-fashioned or not a, you know, they've just, as a sort of strange idea anyway, so maybe it doesn't need to be on the table.
Absolutely. Thank you. So you're also gesturing to the famous thesis by Samuel Huntington on Clash of Civilizations, right? And if we look in terms of ideas, this idea that Islam or Muslims are, you know, incompatible with the West and are some, everything about Islam and about Muslim presence in the West is contradictory. And so those kinds of ideas then also justify particular kinds of actions and policies and so on. So it's important to move away from those binaries, right? And to, understand how much the Muslim presence has shaped Western contacts, right? And not in negative ways, but in very, very positive ways. And there's some interesting work being done around that too. But again, coming back to, I think two of you have mentioned the very important issue around secularization, or laïcité, and the implications for that as an ideology and how that moves into systems. I just want to get to the other comments and then we'll link some of these with systems. Please go ahead.
I think that there is an important problem of lack of knowledge in religious sphere, and it's the burden issue now in the Russian Federation, because after the time of atheism, there is the lack of information about other religions and even of own religion they belong to. And in this situation, people are affected with stereotypes from mass media. Mm. They suppose that Islam is such an aggressive religion and whose God calls to kill non-Muslims and so on. And people even don't understand that we have the same God with Christians and Allah, and that Quran forbids killing non-Muslims and right. Consider Christians as the people of the scripture. And so it's the stereotypes of mass media.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, thank you for raising that and telling us a bit about the context in a sort of post-communist society where religion itself, the very notion of it has had a particular resonance. And so particularly now Islam as a religion that's been highly vilified. And we need to ask the question when you raise stereotypes too, and who do they serve, right? Because ideas are not innocent, right? They're not politically innocent. They have particular operations that they serve. And so it's important to think about that, and I'll come back to a little bit of that later, but thank you. And yes.
My comment really is linked to what was said, not just now, but before, on the binary. What's encouraged by the sort of geopolitical powers that be today is this: you're either for us or against us.
Yeah.
And this fundamental attitude is a root of all forms of antagonism, racism, and basically simple thinking. If we lead yeah. people to just limiting their thinking, if the leaders yeah. of this planet,
yeah.
whichever country they represent, encourage a black-white thinking attitude mm-hmm. and turns very, very complex issues into yeah. a kind of crusade of that's good, that's bad, then we're in trouble. And I think this is the root of all forms of racism, for sure.
Yeah.
It's a lack of understanding, and we can only understand each other if we meet each other.
Right.
And so this is something that I hold very much at heart.
Yes.
And I think that's what peace upholds. The opposite of war is not peace, it's not war.
Right.
War, no war. But peace is a fundamental of existence.
Right.
And we are directed, I think, through a conflictual system that's encouraged in order to obtain power, like you said in your presentation earlier on. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. And that's bringing us back to issues of power, right? Because it is about how we construct self and other in that sense. So those who have the dominant position can and must construct others as abject in order to shore up that dominance. So who do you disavow? Who gets disavowed to become that abject other that then serves to preserve and shore up the dominance of a particular group or nation? And so those are very, very important points. And bring us back to talking from ideas to systems, right? Because if we're just simply talking about individual actions and ideas, then there's an intervention. How we construct a problem, right, also affects how we intervene. So if we see things as matters of only tolerance or intolerance, there's one kind of entry point that we would have. But when we start to broaden and talk about discrimination, which then begins to imply systems, then we need a different kind of intervention. Because it isn't just about individuals and their ideas, good or bad, about people. It becomes about how those ideas and ideologies become mapped into the systems in society. So for example, some of the systems that operate around Islamophobia would be racial profiling, how that happens, denial of jobs, housing, and opportunities. And that happens as well because, and many of you may have experiences like that in the work that you do on front lines where you see those kinds of exclusions. I did a study on homelessness among Muslims and Latin Americans in Toronto right after 9/11, and landlords were refusing to rent to people that had Muslim-sounding names. Right, so people would have to disguise their identity over the phone when they were looking for apartments. So, you know, all of this comes down to the grassroots of people's ability to access safe and affordable housing, find jobs, get social services, and so on. So the systems are also very important. So all these things work together, and it's important to recognize that. These are just some examples that I drew from some of my own research, and I'll just go through them quickly because we've talked a bit about some of these. But, you know, going back to schools, some of the research I did was around Islamophobia in schools. And right after, in terms of individual acts, some of the incidents that we saw were, well, Muslim girls in Toronto public schools, or in one school in particular, were actually targeted for sexual assault because there was a perception, going back to the ideas, right, that they would be reticent to speak and to report crimes. Because there was this idea that Muslim women are backward, oppressed, silent, reticent. And so some girls were sexually assaulted because it was believed that they wouldn't disclose, they wouldn't speak. There were other hate crimes. Hate crimes went up 9/11 in Toronto, and there were acts of a man who was, a 15-year-old boy who was beaten and hospitalized, cars attempting to run down Muslim women as they crossed the street, mosques receiving death threats. Actually, just before I left from Canada, one of our imams in Calgary was actually hit by a car purposely, and a woman got out of the car and started assaulting him then verbally with racial and Islamophobic insults. So again, this is 10 years ago, this is today. There was harassment in schools, kids, you know, changing their names to sound more anglicized so that that might avoid. You know, my son at the time was 13, he's 24 now, his name is Osama. So he has an effect on their sense of identity, their sense of belonging within the nation, and so on. And some girls had, you know, stones thrown at them. So these were some of the individual kinds of actions. These are just some quotes of students that we did a forum on Islamophobia after 9/11, and again, talking about changing their name from Mohammed because it wasn't seen as a good name. Other kids telling me, go back where I came from. And, you know, we have a lot of immigrants and refugees in Canada, and some were feeling like, you know, telling their mothers, well, we came from war and now we're not safe or wanted in this country. And after September 11th, we stopped being seen as Canadian citizens and we became the enemy. So overnight, literally, communities that were seen as relatively peace-loving citizens were transformed into threats to the nation. So those are some of the other... And talking about that, and talking about threats to the nation, I think it's important to draw on Benedict Anderson, who's a scholar who talked about this notion of imagined communities. Right? So when we talk about the state, we talk about an apparatus that to which we have certain rights and responsibilities, and it has rights and responsibilities toward us. But when we talk about the nation, we talk about an imagined community. Right? And how do we imagine the nation, and who do we see as being part of it? And who do we exile from that idea of the nation? And so it's important to distinguish that and think about how the nation gets represented and who are seen as legitimate constituents of that nation and who are seen as dangerous outsiders. And of course that gets shored up through media stereotypes, and that makes all of these ideas very common sense. All of the ideas we talked about you know, seem very common sense to an awful lot of people, right? Even the idea that Muslims are terrorists, need to be feared. And that leads to the miseducation of the public, as those ideas get filtered through the institutions of civil society, such as schools, media, and so on, often also informal sites of education, and get taken up as common sense propositions. So they don't get questioned, right? They don't get interrogated. And those stereotypes and negative ideology serve to justify the racial profiling, securitization, state policies that restrict religion in the public sphere, as well as militarism abroad. So there's a very broad sense of repercussions of these ideas. As I said, they're not simply innocent ideas. There was a clip I was going to show, but I think I'm going to wait because... Should I show it? Do we have time? Okay, I'm going to show this clip so I can stop talking for a minute. But how many of you have seen the documentary Real Bad Arabs by Jack Shaheen? Okay, so this is an American scholar named Jack Shaheen who did... wrote a book called Real Bad Arabs, like R-E-E-L in terms of film reel. And he looked at the representation in Hollywood of Arabs and Muslims from its very beginning. And so there's a very interesting documentary that looks at how those images that we see when we watch Aladdin or when we see films by Arnold Schwarzenegger and all of these kinds of cinema that's very, very ubiquitous and people all around the world see, how that has particular ideas of that we've been talking about, the negative stereotypes about Muslims, and what that has meant. So this is just the trailer. So if we can, thank you, watch that. It's a short, but it'll give you the idea.
We are at war with Iraq. Wasn't that easier? Because for more than a century, we had been vilifying all things Arab. Arabs are the most maligned group in the history of Hollywood. They're portrayed basically as subhumans. We feel that Arabs are not like us, or not like anyone else, then let's kill them all. Then they deserve to die, right? If we cannot save the Arab humanity, what's left?
Thanks. Can I just go back to the PowerPoint? Yeah, so this is just a brief clip of this documentary, which you can find online. It's really fascinating. It takes you all the way through the kind of Orientalism that's been inscribed in American cinema from its inception, and the ways in which Arabs and Muslims get represented. And I think that has a lot to do with, because for a lot of people, you know, if you ask them where do they get a lot of these ideas, they watch a lot of corporate media, they watch cinema, Hollywood films, and so on, that often have very negative kinds of representations, and they often don't have any alternative knowledge. You know, it's interesting, I did some work with teachers developing curriculum, which in the guidelines it refers to a curriculum unit in Ontario called Muslim Women in the 21st Century. And we were doing focus groups with teachers. And I asked them, you know, okay, close your eyes and, you know, tell me what you think of when you think of a Muslim woman. And they would all say things like, well, you know, veiled, walking 10 paces behind their husband, and all of these kinds of, you know, backward stereotypes. And then I would say, well, where do you get your information about Muslims? And they said, well, you know, I saw this film, Not Without Your Daughter, you know, I read Reading Lolita in Tehran, and, you know, so there's a plethora of books, of movies, television, right, that actually reinforce the kinds of negative stereotypes we've been talking about. And for a lot of people, that's their dominant source of knowledge. And so it's important to kind of see where these ideas are further you know, integrated into people's consciousness, you know, in ways that make them a lot harder to dislodge. So that was just, any comments about that or any experiences or things that you've seen in your own experience around media? Yes.
You just sparked a memory for me. I actually saw Not Without My Daughter in my religion class in secondary school. We watched it over 3 weeks for our religion class. We went down to the video room, which was really exciting because we didn't have to do any religion, and we watched Not Without My Daughter. I totally forgotten about that.
And how, what does that teach you about religion? That
yeah, it's film? Amazing, isn't it, that that was seen as an appropriate thing to do in a Catholic secondary school, you know?
Wow. Has everyone know that film, Not Without My Daughter? Okay, there's a book, too. Just for context, it's about a woman, American woman who marries an Iranian, has an Iranian husband. They move to Iran, and they have problems, and she, you know, is leaving the country, trying to sneak out of the country with her daughter. And this film came out quite a long time ago. I would say it was in the 80s, maybe. But the fact that it's being used as curriculum to teach religion, right? And I'm going to get back to curriculum in a minute, but, you know, these are the kinds of ways in which, as I said, these ideas get filtered through, you know, civil institutions, right, civil society, as being very common sense. And so that becomes your Islam lesson, right, is Not Without My Daughter. And that's why we have a lot of the problems we have, and why getting into schools and doing the work around education or in through informal forms of education is so important. Did anyone else have a comment? Yes.
I think we have it on the movies, but also in some comics. If you see the Aladdin, for example, the good guy has no beer, but Jafar, the bad man, has one. And in this kind of vision of person, you can translate some stereotype.
Yeah.
And this is the same for the Jasmine, for example, because in Arabic culture, we like women with the forms, but the Jasmine is a very thin woman, and it's not exactly what we have in Arab culture. But we saw such appropriation of some characteristics, and also we translate inside the Western culture that it's very deeper, and it's spread for all people and young people also.
Yes, absolutely. And so, you know, those caricatures of, you know, Arab stereotypes of Aladdin, the characters in that Jafar, who's darker skinned, right? That's the other kind of archetype, is that the sort of nefarious, villainous characters are always more, have dark skin. The heroines and the heroes are lighter skinned. So we begin to read those tropes through various forms of culture, cultural production, cinema, books, literature, and often a lot of them for the consumption of children. Right? So, you know, they're learning these at a very young age, right? So these ideas get filtered into their consciousness in a very young age. Yeah. Thank you. I think someone had their hand up. Yes. We'll go here.
Oh, sorry. Can I just want to talk about a personal experience that I had. Last year, I was at the European Parliament as a trainee, and I think I was the only hijabi in the entire parliament, besides the manual workers, so the cleaners.
Ah.
And I had this one experience with my supervisor, and he was a really, really nice man, and I don't think he meant it in a bad way in any way. But we were walking together, but I was a bit slow because he was quite tall, and so he would obviously walk faster than I did. But he said, you know, this is not India or Arabia, you know, you can walk on the same level as me. And I was just like, okay, it's not the fact that you're really tall, but it's the fact that I have to walk behind you.
Yes.
But it's just... I found that really strange because he's an employee of the parliament, and it's supposed to be the most democratic EU institution. And I mean, that's just one of the very many experiences that I had there. But yeah, I think it's these ingrained ideas and stereotypes that we need to crush.
Absolutely. Yeah, thank you for that example. I mean, that's incredible too, how everything gets reduced to your religion, right, or to your culture, not to, you know, one size or, right, exactly. Because for some reason that notion is very much embedded in people's sensibilities, that for some reason Muslim women must walk behind men. I've never actually seen that happen ever anywhere, but it, you know, the fact that that is something that still people have ideas about is very incredible. Yeah, thank you. Sorry, go ahead.
It's also a personal experience that show how images affect build stereotypes. I was once talking to a girl, and I ended up saying I was Muslim, and she made that crazy link, saying, oh, it's like the TV show Homeland. So for those who do not know Homeland, it's about terrorism.
Right.
So I had to justify, like, no, Islam is not terrorism. I mean, just to...
Yeah, so there you go. So, I mean, you know, and I'm sure others have had this experience too, where people are defining you based on what they've seen on American television or in films, or, you know, their Orientalist ideas about who Muslim women are or how they behave. And it really takes away people's agency, right? Your ability to be an agentic subject, to be who you are, because you are often defined by stereotypes. So the fact that it takes away your agency to say, this is who I am, this is my identity, you know, for a lot of Muslims in general, but Muslim women who are visibly Muslim or become identified, there's a whole other layer. I'm going to talk a bit about gendered Islamophobia in a minute, but this whole other layer of your identity that people assume before they've even met you. You know, you're actually become put into a category that you've had no part in creating, and you have to deal with that stereotype. And they can't deal with you as an individual until, you know, that stereotype gets demystified first, right? So you have to do that explaining of, well, it's okay, I'm not really a terrorist, or, you know, all of that sort of thing. And so that's tiring, right, among other things, among other being disturbing and an assault on people's individual agency. But it's also exhausting to kind of always have to respond to those sorts of things. So thank you, everyone, for sharing those experiences. Yes?
I have a very good German friend who is not Islamophobic, at least in his actions. Once I asked him what kind of image appears in his mind when he thinks of a Muslim man, and the answer was very interesting for me. He said, he thinks about a man who says Allahu Akbar and then bombs.
Wow.
So this was a very clear indication for me of the fact that media was the root cause of Islamophobia, because he showed he did not make any actions mm-hmm. that was Islamophobic, but deep in his conscious, he had some Islamophobic thoughts or images in his mind.
Yeah, wow, that's very powerful too, right? That's again what, you know, a billion people around the world, 1.5 billion people get reduced to that narrative or to that image. So that's very powerful and very troubling, and why this kind of work is so important, to create a counter narrative to the way those kinds of constructions are being so commonly taken up. Thank you. Okay, let me just move on a bit. So we were talking about curriculum. I just wanted to raise that again because a lot of this conversation is about education. In a recent book that I co-edited, I wrote a chapter on a series that's used in Canada and the U.S. I don't know, maybe in Europe too, called Shibanu, Daughter of the Desert. And it was written by an American reporter who lived in Pakistan for 3 months and then became an expert and wrote a trilogy or series about this girl, Shibanu, and her life in the desert. I'm not going to go over the story, but this was a quote by someone critiquing, you know, this curriculum. And what happens after, you know, not without my daughter is shown in school or this book is read in school. What happens when these stories about Muslim women that are being told, what happens to the girls in schools after that? How are they treated on the basis of those stereotypes? And so she notes that since the targeted audience, which was seventh graders, are generally not equipped to make the distinction between religion and culture, it's common for them to ask Muslim girls such telling questions after reading this novel, Shibanu, like, do you drive? How old were you when you were married? Were you forced to marry your husband? Have there been instances of, and there's also been instances of Muslim girls being teasingly called Shibanu. So when these kinds of curriculum are brought into schools, it has an effect on the girls that it's supposed to represent in terms of how the assumptions that are made about them, about their families, about their lives. And so it's important that we look at the effect of that kind of curriculum and work to combat it. Okay, and then just going to now systemic factors. Again, racial profiling, and that happens in communities, right? Borders and schools. Right? There's a whole kind of racial profiling that goes on in schools. In the UK, you have the Prevent policy, right, which has teachers profiling in schools, looking at would-be extremists and so on. There's this whole notion of flying while Muslim. I had a clip for that, but we don't have a lot of time, but I can show you another time if you're interested. That's the term that's been used for the experience of Muslims who are flying and having to go through extra checks at borders and airports and so on. Various forms of surveillance and securitization are other systemic processes that have happened in many, many nations, including Canada, where our immigration policies and security policies are very much intertwined and often are specifically targeting Muslims. Discrimination in employment, housing, healthcare, education, and social services, as well as social, economic, and political policies. So the idea of Islamophobia isn't just something that circulates among individuals in a society, but it's very much mapped into the way policies are constructed in all levels of social, political, economic, and so on. Anyone want to add to that level of discussing policy? No? Okay, it would be an exhaustive topic anyways. So related to that, when we're starting to look at the upper levels of how Islamophobia connects to policies and practices of the state, is this notion of paranoid nationalism, I'm drawing on Gus and Hage's work in Australia for that term, but we see it in Europe with this idea of Eurabia that was created, right, or Fortress Europe, and the way xenophobia is another carrier of Islamophobia, or mechanism through which Islamophobia gets realized. This fear of the dangerous foreigner, these are some political cartoons. One here, you can kind of see this young white girl wrapped up in the European Union flag with this sort of orientalist, you know, Arab male coming with a sword. Again, very primitivized kinds of constructions of this takeover. So people were talking about that earlier, about this sort of takeover, the Muslims are coming, they're taking over, you know, and this
you know, this sort of ideology shores up the kind of resistance there is to religious accommodations that people are asking for, whether in schools or other places, like, you know, not serving pork or allowing girls to wear hijab during physical education classes and so on, or accommodations in the workplace for people to pray, all of these sorts of things. So this kind of idea of, well, now they're taking over, this is not just in Europe. In the United States, there's this whole idea of the creeping Sharia, they call it, right? Even though there's no Sharia law in the United States, they still have an assault against what they call creeping Sharia, in Canada too. And so this is again a prevalent kind of idea of when the nation becomes troubled and there's this anxiety, this paranoia and anxiety around, you know, that changing. I think particularly, you know, here in Europe we see that, but it's not exclusive to Europe. And that leads to xenophobia and Islamophobic violence. And so I just... you know, this easily gets swept under the rug, although it's a terrible issue, of course, in Norway with Anders Breivik, and you know, who bombed government buildings in Oslo, killing 8 people, and then killed 69 more people, mostly teenagers, in the mass shooting at the Workers' Youth League in Norway. August 2012, he was convicted of mass murder, causing fatal explosion and terrorism. Breivik wrote a lengthy manifesto citing the evils of multiculturalism and Islamic demographic warfare as an impetus for his actions. Claiming to defend Norway against multiculturalism and Islam, he said the attacks were intended as a punishment of the traitors whose pro-immigration policies were adulterating Norwegian blood. Some of you from Norway? Yeah. Do you have any feedback on this?
I think one thing is Breivik, but I think what's more interesting is the debate that followed the 22nd of July, because that debate was a debate on whether he was a crazy man or not, not about his ideology,
right?
Not about what
not
he
his
stood for.
Manifesto.
Yeah, exactly. Not about his manifesto.
Right.
Not about the multiple, you know, political parties and other organizations that were very prominent in the public debate that was kind of sympathizing with a lot of his ideas. Nothing about that. That was, the debate was about whether he was a crazy man or not. And that says, I think that says a lot about, you know, this is not about us.
Right.
You know, but when it's about a Muslim terrorist and all of a sudden
everybody's
it's about
implicated.
Islam.
Yes.
I think that's just very important.
I don't know
about you. Yeah, I agree.
Maybe you could turn your mic on.
Oh, okay. There have been no debate about this in Norway after the 22nd of July. The day that followed, they said that they would make political debates about it, but they never did. And also the leader of the Labour Party, he wrote a book about it recently where he said that we have to take that debate, but it doesn't help to write a book saying that we have to take it when you don't actually do it.
Right.
And when we don't do it in Norway, I suppose it's even worse in the rest of Europe that haven't had such a terror attack.
Yes. Yeah, so it's very interesting to hear the aftermath of this and the kind of public discourse and debate that had nothing to do with, you know, his manifesto or his ideology, but rather his sanity, right? And, yes, go on.
In Norway, we have like huge debates about the IS and about radicalization for Muslim youth. And till now, there haven't been a terror attack or any violence implementing the Muslim youth of Norway.
Yes.
And even still, that is the big debate. And also, there was a debate on TV, and the headline was "When is the terror coming closer to Norway?" And that debate was like 1 year after the 22nd of July.
Wow.
And of course they meant the Islamic terrorists.
Exactly.
And not terrorism in general.
Right.
So that's the Norwegian debate.
Wow, thank you for sharing that. And it comes back to also, you know, the idea of who do we see as a terrorist, right? And it can't be one of our own. Then the issues of mental health, you know, get read into that conversation in ways they never do if the perpetrator is a person of color or particularly Muslim, right? It then becomes endemic to Islamic culture rather than something that is committed by someone who, you know, may be unstable. or mental health is never brought in. It's always the alibi when it comes to perpetrators that are, are generally white men. And that goes with a lot of the school shootings in the United States, right? Those are the conversations. There's a real reticence to name those as terrorist acts, you know, which is important to consider. Yes.
So I think that's one of the most frustrating things every time there's a similar attack, is that the Muslim person is automatically, the reason for their violence is automatically seen because of their religion, whereas with the non-Muslim, non-brown perpetrator, it's generally a mental illness. This is what I found really interesting with this recent developments with ISIS is in the UK, they are proposing legislation where you are automatically seen as a threat if you visit that region. Wow. And there's no room to argue. Mm. So it was really interesting to see that some of these people who had actually traveled there purchased books like Islam for Dummies.
Right.
So they had very little knowledge of Islam to begin with.
Right.
But that's never really in mainstream media at all. So.
Very true. And the whole discourse of the Muslim radical, the jihadist Muslim youth, there's been a term called the moniker of the jihadist generation. You know, are a few examples that we're starting to see, but that gets mapped onto all Muslim youth as being potential. Is that for me, that note? Thank you. As being potential terrorists. So, very important to consider, especially in the current geopolitical context. Okay. I'm going to go a little quickly because I only have 10 minutes, but I think it's important also in terms of recognizing that Islamophobia doesn't just affect Muslims or those who are deemed or identify as Muslims, but those who are misidentified as Muslims. The example that I have up here are about Sikhs. And there's been a lot of violence against Sikhs who are perceived to be Muslim because they wear a turban. In fact, one of the first deaths in the United States after 9/11 was of a Sikh man who, and I've mentioned it here, Balbir Singh Sodhi, a turban Sikh, a gas station owner who was killed after being mistaken for an Arab American by a gunman looking to shoot a Muslim. In 2013, there was an attack on a Gurdwara or Sikh temple and killed five and injured several people, and it was believed that the perpetrator had mistaken the temple for a mosque. A rampant increase in hate crimes against Sikhs since 9/11 because of that misidentification. So just to recognize that Islamophobia doesn't only just affect Muslims, but anyone deemed to be Muslim. These are just, I was going to talk a bit, but we've already been talking a bit about this gendered Islamophobia and how Islamophobia also, when it is connected to women and Muslim women's identities, has its own kind of manifestation that we can look at in cinema and films and various kinds of representation. These are just some of the various things that you can get the metaphors very easily from these kinds of political cartoons. The ad in the middle is from Vogue magazine in 1993. Again, an example that Islamophobia didn't begin on September 12th. So you see the ad in the middle where you have a woman who's supposed to be Muslim, darker skin, same model with light skin and a baseball cap that has an American flag. The writing that you can't see under the Muslim woman with the veil says something like, women should be submissive, quiet, reticent, and obedient, and very, very serious. And then you have the image of the other woman who's wearing a baseball cap, same model, her skin's lighter now, and the writing underneath the ad says women should be fun, flirty, wild, bold, and very, very, you know, and it names the company for this ad. I won't give them any extra credit. But this came out in 1993, and that came out during the Persian Gulf War. So again, these kinds of images were also being purveyed in ways that helped shore up that particular military intervention in Iraq and attacks in Iraq, because that was often touted as a way to bring liberation to Muslim women. So Muslim women's bodies have been ideological battlegrounds in many of the current conflicts, and Islamophobia has been a mechanism to ensure that. I'll just signal, this is just some examples about gendered Islamophobia. One thing I'll just mention is in Canada, like we've heard about some of the policies of banning the hijab in public places in Europe, in France, in Belgium, and I think in Germany as well, in Turkey, other places. In Canada, we have in Quebec Bill 94, which is to ban the niqab, the face veil, and this is going through Quebec legislation and with a lot of popular support, including support of the government, the federal government. And the consequences for women, if they should, should this come through, is that if they continue to wear the niqab, they could be denied social services. Right, so that becomes a real implication of how these policies can affect their day-to-day lives and existences. So that's a Canadian example of gendered Islamophobia. I always love to talk about resistance because that's really where we need to reside now. And these are just some examples of, you know, some ads where women are protesting wearing, you know, the French national flag. This one refers to FIFA, soccer. Football, now that I'm in Europe, I have to say Football Association, that had banned headscarves but has recently changed that ruling. And so there's many different ways that, you know, Muslim women bodies get policed in the public sphere, and Islamophobia is it's a representation as well as a reason for Islamophobia. And there's also the World Hijab Day that's happening as well now. So these are just some quick examples. This is just to show that Islamophobia in its reach has affected even the most powerful man in the world, Barack Obama, who's often criticized by his detractors as being Muslim to this day, right? So this was an image from the New Yorker. This was during around the campaign for his presidency, with him dressed in Taliban garb, other images that, you know, portray him as being either a Muslim or a Muslim sympathizer. So even the most powerful man in the world is not immune from being victimized by Islamophobia. So I want to touch on this. I think it's very important, the Islamophobia industry, because there is an industry that supports these kinds of images and them and how they're purveyed. These are some of the American, well, I have, you know, Geert Wilders here because, you know, you're in Europe, you have to reference him as well. But in terms of some of the others, you have like Ann Coulter, who's very popular in the American right-wing neoconservative Tea Party type movement, as well as Michelle Bachmann and others who are part of an Islamophobia network like Steve Emerson, David Horowitz, and others. And so now, these are people who are very openly Islamophobic. There was a recent study done called Fear Inc., The Roots of the Islamophobia Network in America, that actually traced where the money comes from to support these networks. And it's quite an industry. And so it was a six-month investigation into this research project that was published by the Center for American Progress. And they revealed that $42 million from seven foundations over the past decade have helped fan the flames of anti-Muslim hate in America. And the money has flowed into the hands of five key experts and so-called scholars who comprise the central nervous system of anti-Muslim propaganda. And some of these are like Pamela Geller, Bridget Gabriel, David Horowitz, Robert Spencer, for organizations like Stop Islamization of America, Jihad Watch, and Act for America. And the report details information that is then disseminated through conservative organizations like the Eagle Forum, the Religious Right, Fox News, and politicians like Alan West and Newt Gingrich. And so you start to see, again, under the surface, right, what's operating in terms of what kind of money is being raised to support these individuals and these organizations that have made it their business to create and disseminate anti-Muslim propaganda. Another example, I don't know how many of you have seen the documentary film called Obsession, Radical Islam's War Against the West, or The Third Jihad. These were came from these same networks and were circulated in about, I forget the, maybe it was 70,000 newspapers in the United States during the initial campaign to elect Barack Obama in the swing states in the United States. So we just inserted into newspapers, so people would get this documentary, and into the Chronicle of Higher Education that goes out to every university practically across the globe was added as an insert. So there's a very wide reach to the way this propaganda is created and disseminated, and there's deep pockets that fund this. So this isn't just a conspiracy theory. There's some very good research showing the money trail. So I thought it was important to recognize that. One of the movements of these groups is called Islamofascism. This is another term that they've coined. These Islamophobia networks. They now have on some 200 campuses across the United States Islamofascism Week, where they bring up various issues vilifying Islam and Muslims. And you can see some of these books that come out by Bridget Gabriel, for example, that purvey these kinds of notions of the Islamofascist boogeyman. And this was an interesting meme that I saw that says, you know, no one thinks these people are representative of Christians. You have the KKK, and then you have representations of ISIS. So why do so many people think that these are representatives of Muslims, right? It's an interesting position that it presents, but part of why we don't see that so clearly is because this Islamophobia industry is out there churning away, and the propaganda mill is quite strong, especially in American corporate media. I wanted to point out that even within communities that are Muslim, there are dissidents that are very much espousing Islamophobic hate. In Canada, there's two examples of that I have put up here, Irshad Manji's book, The Trouble with Islam, and Tariq Fateh from the Muslim Canadian Congress, as well as Ayan Hirsi Ali, of just some of those who identify as being Muslim and see themselves as dissidents and are now very much seen as legitimate voices because they've had that experience and now they can claim to speak with a certain kind of authority. And so it's important to look at Islamophobia coming from Muslim places as well. Okay, so just in closing, I just want to touch a little bit about Muslim youth and what I call the 9/11 generation. And this is just based on some of my research on Muslim youth in Canada over the last 5 years. And so this effect of everything we've talked about has a strong impact on how Muslim youth have their sense of citizenship, identity, and belonging. And a lot of that is concerns that they have are exacerbated by the kind of surveillance and targeting of Muslim youth at the level of government policies, at the level of universities as well. The NYPD in the United States had been actively targeting Muslim student associations and spying on them. And we see not so much the spying aspect in Canada, but generally the scrutiny on Muslim student associations there as well. And so there is this perception that Muslim youth are, you know, potential terrorists, potential radicals, and this sort of scrutiny on their practices, on their organizations, on what they do, has become very internalized by a lot of Muslim youth. So when I ask them, when I talk to youth and say, you know, how did 9/11 affect you? A lot of them, because of their age, this is the only world they've known. They don't know an existence prior to 9/11 or what the world was like for others. And so first they'll say, no, it really didn't affect me. And then when I probe further and I start to ask, well, you know, what are your student groups doing on campus? They'll say things like, well, you know, we debated for months whether we should go up north and play paintball. You know, we didn't want to be seen as a terrorist cell, right? Or we don't play violent video games in the concourse of the university anymore because we don't want people to, you know, be afraid that we're Muslim youth playing violent video games. So, but then again, 9/11 didn't affect them, right? So it's all about how this has become a new normal for a lot of Muslim youth. They have internalized this oppression and Islamophobia in ways that makes them self-surveilling subjects. They surveil themselves. They consider their actions. We can't just, you know, my son's in the Muslim Student Association and he was telling me, we're gonna do a retreat up in the woods. And I was like, you know, I don't know if you guys should go into the woods and have a bonfire because that could be a risk. People could wonder about why are these Muslim youth congregating in the woods, right? So they can't, their innocence is gone. Innocent actions that other youth would do, they have to think twice about, right? And so they become self-surveilling subjects where they have to consider the jokes they say in public, the actions that they do, because how they may be misread within this context of Islamophobia. But there's a lot of Muslim youth activism and resistance, which is really important, and I see that as a form of public pedagogy. So let me, in closing, just touch on a few things that I think are really interesting interventions in terms of the arts. We have a show in Canada called Little Mosque on the Prairie. It was the number one show in Canada, created by a good friend of mine, Zarka Nawaz. And there were, I think, 5 or 6 seasons of the show. There's an interesting documentary called The Muslims Are Coming, which is Muslim comedians talking about their work and doing comedy in the context of 9/11. And then the other one is actually a show called Fame and Fidelity that's on the web, and that's my son. It's his series. He's a Muslim actor who has always been typecast as a terrorist. He always gets called in to read for terrorist number 4, terrorist number 3. So he started to talk about and begin to interrogate through comedy and through this show how what it is to try and break out of that stereotype as a young actor. And there's also important interventions like the hijabi monologues which is kind of based on the vagina monologues, but it's actually women not talking about hijab. It's specifically Muslim women talking about things that affect them that aren't about hijab. So it's a very interesting concept, and it's done in theater form all over the U.S. and in some places in Canada. And an interesting group called Conflict Relief, again, youth-based, Palestinian and Israeli comedians, who met at a school in London, theater school, and decided to work together to create comedic performances and then also do interventions and facilitation afterwards to discuss some of the issues that come up around Palestine and Israel and the conflicts there. And so these are very, I think, hopeful places to leave this discussion, because I think this is where, for me, the very powerful generative spaces of combating Islamophobia reside in the work that you are all doing, in the work that youth do. And there's, I was going to show some spoken word, but I realized that spoken word artists are often, when they're speaking English, are hard to understand, so I didn't, but these are a few artists that I think are very notable. Soher Hamad, Rafif Ziada, Linda Sarsour, and Safiya Beg. You can look them up on YouTube, and they have interesting interventions on a lot of these issues. And again, some other comedy troupes that are important, I think, as a place to talk about, you know, how we can bring these issues to light in a different way and get conversations going. And comedy, for me, spoken word are really good ways to do that, and very youth-friendly approaches. So it may be relevant to some of you in the work that you do as entry points to that conversation. This was some curriculum that we did, that I worked on for elementary schools. It's referenced in the guidelines, but it's just a way of sort of asking students to identify images of who they think are Canadian, who they think are Muslim. And it's very interesting that they define the Canadians as those who aren't religiously marked. So that was just an activity that we did. And finally, to end it, always with the wonderful educator, educational scholar Paulo Freire, and his comment that education either functions as an instrument which is used to facilitate integration of the younger generation into the logic of the present system and bring about conformity, or it becomes the practice of freedom, the means by which men and women deal critically and creatively with reality and discover how to participate and transform their world. And I think that's the project of for many of us and for this forum. So thank you very much for your time and attention.
Thank you very, very much, Jasmine, for this tour de force and for this very, I think, complete and inspiring and raising questions input. I will not take questions now, because I think we also need to digest it a bit and think over, but we are coming back in the afternoon and we are addressing some of the questions and the issues that Jasmine also addressed in her presentation with more time to do so, also in small working groups, and also to let you know that Jasmine is with us for the whole duration of the seminar, so we don't need to exhaust her expertise now in 1 hour and a half, but she's with us and she's also participating with us in the seminar. Good. With this being said, I would ask you to put up on that wall, to stick the expectations, fears, concerns, contributions before you go to lunch, and to invite you to come back here at 2:30. But to be here and ready to start at 2:30. I understand that there are some people who have not visited my colleague for travel reimbursement issues.